Hello, everyone. John Hardy here with the Saxo Bank Video FX update and looking at the weekly wrap this week. Though UK was out on holiday today, I think quite a bit to talk about. A lot of it just continuation of the themes we've been seeing, and hopefully a couple of interesting charts and things to point out here as we've seen a pretty dramatic action in gold market today. Again, the dollar tending toward the weak side, certainly against the commodities, commodity complex mostly higher on the day. And really not a whole lot new in the terms of themes, but a couple things to point out in terms of perspective on all of this. Some highlights very quickly: strong New Zealand trade balance. We saw some signs of Kiwi weakness off the other side of the RBNZ. People seeing this weakness as an excuse just to jump back right back in there and get back on that trend. So yet again we see a sign of a technical reversal not holding and the overall trend really exerting its influence immediately in the wake of this. So this is an interesting pattern we're seeing of late. German retail sales were weak, but we shouldn't care. I did a pretty funny study looking at the index of where German retail sales are, and just to show you what an export-based economy it is. Basically, they're at something like index 92 or 95 compared to 1990. So they're selling less than they were back at reunification, according to the official retail sales figures anyway. Whereas you take a country like Sweden, there versus 1997, so just 14, 15 years ago, they're at index 175 versus 100 then. So gives you an idea. Who cares about retail sales in Germany? It's all about the export data, all about how those companies are doing there, and the economy quite strong in Germany still by all accounts. Though we wonder if it's just from the sheer momentum it's built up, whether it could at least be looking at a slowing momentum going forward. Certainly some commodity prices coming into play here that could blunt demand. Getting off track a bit there, weak Canadian GDP figure for February. This was quickly wiped aside by the market as the commodities theme re-exerted. There's also been a bit of nervousness with the upcoming election. I'll get to that in a moment. It's the middle of winter. There were some big production shutdowns, factory shutdowns, what have you, in Canada. I think we can write this off. The Canadian economy still looks strong. This is a one-off figure for now, and other fundamentals supporting CAD. Chicago PMI was still very strong at 67 point something, but not quite as strong as expected, and losing a bit of momentum off the previous month. Still very strong PMI manufacturing numbers out of the U.S., though we did see a couple of disappointments in the some of these regional numbers this month, so something to bear in mind in terms of the momentum shift. Michigan confidence revised slightly lower, but still better than March, and if you ask me, just locally speaking, in terms of confidence, I would say it's reasonable confidence considering where we are in gas prices and how they've ramped of late. Interesting news out of Finland, with the true Finns possibly backing off on the hard line of their stance on EU bailouts if they're given a carrot in terms of something, some kind of jobs package for the local economy. So they're going to use their new power negotiations for other parts of their platform. This is quite kind of a surprise, really. Not seeing a lot of support for the euro and some of the crosses, if you look at euro sterling, euro Swiss, but still an interesting development. And we did see eurozone sovereign debt spreads coming back in a bit. Of course, if we're ignoring the three basket cases of Portugal, Ireland, and Greece, which at least I think in Portugal's case it was wider on the day. Yen and Swiss stronger. We're seeing very strong bond markets. This supports those two currencies. We're also seeing the yen spiking to new highs versus the dollar today ahead of this Golden Week in Japan, which is basically a week off for many, or many Japanese take the week off. It started today and runs through most of next week. There may be a couple trading days later in the week that are open, but basically we should consider Japan offline for next week. And as I said earlier, the dollar generally weak on the day. The commodities are very strong. We have the second highest crude ever, or not ever, but in the recent cycle on the Brent, and another rally on the day in the U.S. We're seeing grains up quite strongly, 23 cents, for example, in the case of wheat, and silver up, but gold really the star performer. 1561 is the price we're closing close to on COMEX, and that is for the June contract. Pretty amazing. It's a $30 day in gold on top of already record highs recently. So clearly the whole theme of fear of fiat currencies, the credibility of the Fed, et cetera, having quite a bit of weight there. So in terms of themes, what I just said, dollar, can anything stop bleeding? Are we headed towards a dollar crisis? What does the bond strength mean? It means the end of the Swiss upside for now. But also, I think, as I've been saying recently, it's kind of sticks out like a sore thumb in terms of the other themes we have ongoing, especially the first one there. If we're all supposed to be disbelieving of the U.S.'s ability to pay off its debts and running, screaming from the currency wire or bonds, which represent sort of a faith and trust in being paid eventually in that currency, why are they continuing to see so much strength? And just for perspective, it seems all markets are aligned here except for bonds. Bonds have been back and forth a bit, but if we look at the risk in terms of commodity prices, in terms of dollar downside, and in terms of equity and other risk market upside, we just did a couple of comparisons here and sort of ask a question here. If on November 1st, which was basically the day before QE2 officially started, though it started ramping before that, of course, with the warning from Jackson Hole in late August. Anyway, we saw oil 85, euro dollar around 139, S&P at 1184. Now, 5 months later, May 1st being tomorrow, we see oil at 126, euro dollar 148, S&P 1363. Well, does that mean 5 months from now all these trends are going to continue? We're on this great trend. It's wonderful. We'll keep going. No pause in momentum. It goes on forever with no missing a beat. Are we supposed to see oil at 185? And in that case, would euro trade 160? I would say possibly in that case. But more importantly, would S&P be trading 1570? Hard to imagine that one. 50% further increase from here in oil prices is going to be extremely disruptive for demand. And at some point, something has to break here. You can't have everything going in an upward spiral. At some point, demand gets affected. At some point, these real prices in the real economy do mean something. And I would suggest, of course, that this inflection point comes with the end of QE2. It's only 2 months away. The anticipation part of the cycle has to come into play before the actual end of the event. So on that note, and on the note of our chief economist, Stane Jakobsen's comments on the Trading Floor blog, please see that article, Stane's Chronicle, him pointing out after being at a conference with Mish, the famed blogger, we always have to remember that when complacency is extremely high, volatility is extremely low, risk is actually extremely high and extremely underappreciated. And this is something we need to keep in mind. Also as well, even if the dollar doesn't strengthen, its weakness at some point becomes a trigger for risk aversion as well, and that could have implications in various crosses, etc. So let's not get complacent here, folks. Let's always be careful out there, that being the main message, and to not read not to accept the low volatility readings we're seeing at face value. Looking ahead, we still have another UK holiday on Monday. Again, next week is this Golden Week in Japan. And seasonally, I think it's very interesting. You have the stay away in May saying, because of the historical seasonal patterns in equity markets. That might be the case here, of course. One reason might be the QE2, but we'll see. And next week, very busy. We've got U.S. data, of course, the two ISMs. Looking for the possibility of some momentum coming off there, and the employment figure as well. And three central bank meetings, RBA on Tuesday, Bank of England and ECB on Thursday, and a Canadian employment report on Friday, around the same time as the U.S. employment figure. If you'd like to follow me on Twitter, you can add me to your stream. My name is at John J. Hardy. One thing I dragged up here that I thought would be interesting for perspective, and I hope folks will remind me to pull this chart out once in a while to refresh it and have a look at it. I'm trying to figure out, of course, when the risk appetite move turns around. One interesting measure is margin debt in the New York Stock Exchange, as a measure of how many people or how exuberant the market is getting on using debt to finance stock purchases. And here we see that the only two times where we've seen strong new highs in the equity market without a new high in margin debt, we're right at the turning points here in September of 2000. This is not the NASDAQ turnaround, of course. This is the broader market turnaround. And again in late 07, where we saw the late October high, but margin debt not expanding to new highs for the cycle. Of course, we're seeing the symbiosis here again, of course, people borrowing to buy more, and that helps to finance the further stock purchases. What we'd look for, of course, is a new high in the stocks, and with margin debt not following suit. So we'll try to keep an eye on that one. Unfortunately, it's a monthly figure, but it could give the signal in terms of a longer-term resistance to further upside. In the meantime, at least in terms of this measure, everything looks just hunky-dory, even though we've sent out a couple of warning signs in this and other broadcasts. In terms of the FX charts, not finding any momentum today. Specifically, we've had quite a sharp move here. Of course, today we've had a UK offline. Everything looks like the trend is the trend. Maybe a little bit of steepness here. We've seen a couple of these run-ups having a hard time sustaining for a while, and it takes a little while to consolidate, so that's possibly a risk, but certainly nothing threatening the trend at this time. The reversal signal not seeing any follow-through in cable. Euro sterling, I think, looks a bit interesting. New high here versus that old high around 89.25 or wherever it was. Not finding further traction. We saw a reversal there. So it could mean this range is going to hold for now. Euro Swiss, a bit of a surprise, but if we look at the bond market, maybe less so. Certainly now the Euro Swiss upside argument is going to take some challenges. We need to see it back above this area here towards 130 before we can believe that there's upside potential now after this after today. Euro Yen, likewise, strong bond markets mean the lowest yielders are performing well. It's been interesting too. We've wiped out most of this very strong bar we saw a couple of days ago. And all yen at a new low here recently since the post. Post-tsunami's earthquake rally. 80 is the big figure there. Ichimoku cloud, etc. I think a psychological key as well. Here you're seeing the June Brent contract closing at the second highest price for the cycle. You're seeing Dollar Canada at first looking a bit resilient to the sell-off, especially compared to other currencies. But today's figure not serving to hold it back, hold the Canadian dollar back. We have an election on Monday, remember that. And one of our favorite ideas for the time being is that we might, if we're thinking there's a bit too much of a premium of fear built into the Canadian dollar because of this NDP party in Canada and its chances in the election and the possibility that it gets more influence than people suspected previously in the government. If there's too much of a fear premium priced in, one might consider whether something like Aussie Canada is getting way too expensive here. You could say it's understandable to see the Aussie dollar perhaps spiking out of control. But from where I sit, we see copper closing at the lowest level in April today, and not much further than that is the lowest for the year. We have all kinds of wild shenanigans going on in China about these crazy copper transactions and using them as collateral. You can follow that on Alpha Bill. There's all kinds of links there. They're even using zinc and things like this. So to fade some of that craziness, I'm wondering if someone is going to be looking at these Aussie versus something like CAD and seeing excessive valuations here. And now we have, after today, and ahead of a key event risk, an interesting candle, an interesting reversal. So let's keep an eye on that, see what happens in Aussie Canada in the coming couple of weeks. Here's that Kiwi chart, the momentum play, divergence play, et cetera, et cetera. Just bearing absolutely no fruit here in the short term, as there seems to be no hope for the dollar. Aussie, fourth strong day to the upside, closing at a new high. And we showed you that one. And here we have BHP, not seeing any downside yet, but not seeing a new highs for the cycle either. So perhaps a bit less support than would be like for those looking for Aussie dollar higher. Again, the copper low here worries me a bit for the idea that the Aussie should be making new highs across the board. The various stirs there, not terribly interesting. Bunds, new local high, which is kind of interesting for Euro Yen downside potential. And equities, look at that, another high for the cycle, and no sign that the bears have any chance of gaining the upper hand for the time being. So that is our weekly wrap. We have, again, lots of stuff coming up next week with the U.S. economic data risks and with the three central bank meetings. Be aware of that. Be aware that, of course, the main point we're trying to make today in our comments is that, of course, ironically, as risk perception goes lower and lower, it sort of serves as almost like building up a store as leverage increases for the potential for volatility to actually become greater after such an episode. And we saw this back in 06 and 07, where you almost had to pay to take risk, and what it resulted in 08. We're not going to try to say that we're looking for a repeat of 08, just that any high leverage, high leverage but high complacency environment is rather dangerous, and difficulty being, of course, in declaring a timing of when that comes unwound. So be careful out there more than ever, and don't let those warning words get your weekend out. Have a great weekend, and we'll see you back next week with more of the Saxo Bank video updates. Take care out there.